Houston, Texas. Houston is the acknowledged corporate world headquarters of the oil and gas industry. Virtually all major oil and gas related companies are based in Houston. The past few years have been difficult ones for the oil and gas industry, and it shows here in Houston. But there is a bright spot. The brightest spot on Houston's skyline in the newly constructed Heritage Plaza is the new corporate headquarters of Great Western Resources. Great Western has managed to survive the oil industry storms and to grow in just 5 years from a $1,000 company to a corporation worth more than $300 million. Great Western is one of the few major independent oil and gas corporations that has shown growth in recent years. Its president, Dan Pena Sr., is committed to seeing that growth continue. Recently, Great Western held an open house to show its new offices and bring together those people that made Great Western grow. This program will introduce you to some of those key people and present their opinions of Great Western and its phenomenal success. First, a few words with Dan Pena Sr., Chairman, President, and Chief Executive Officer of Great Western Resources.
I started with less than $1,000 when I founded the company. And I come from working class parents. And so I didn't start this company with a great deal of money. Most of the people that I was raised with turned out to be doctors, lawyers, dentists, and all from working class, but they went to school. And I didn't take school seriously, although I did ultimately graduate with honors from a California university. I think that the real turning point for me was when I was in the military, went to OCS during our great Vietnam conflict, and came out. I was an intelligence officer with NATO, at NATO headquarters. And I came back to school, and I came back to school with a vengeance. And I think that was really the beginning. And I've been fairly successful at whatever I've done in the two or three endeavors. Well, when I was with Bear Stearns in the middle 70s, I saw oil go from $6 a barrel to $12 a barrel. And it didn't take a Harvard MBA to figure out that the great fortunes were being made. So I was fortunate enough to be offered a position with one of our, at that time, corporate finance clients. And I went to work for a company called Kennedy Industries. And I was made an offer I couldn't refuse. And within a year's time, the name of the company was changed to JPK, which stood for Jensen Pena Kennedy. And I was a major shareholder. I subsequently, on January 7, 1982, lost a proxy fight and was unceremoniously thrown out on my derriere. And I founded Great Western Resources, as we know it now, on Friday the 13th, July 1982. To be more accurate, we started the company with $820. And when we founded the company, Mr. Harrison, Mr. Soliday, who's recently passed away, and myself, our goal was to be the 50th largest exploration production company in the United States. In 1982, that company was Pennzoil. And as you probably read, Pennzoil is a lot bigger than the 50th largest company in the United States now. And if it wins its lawsuit against Texaco, it could probably be one of the top five or six. Our goal is still to be the 50th largest. This year, we will break into probably the top 80s. And now that we are also a natural resource company, I mean, truly, with the coal acquisition, we are one of the largest coal companies, coal operating companies in the United States as well. Well, originally we started with drilling funds, which were the rage in the late 70s and early 80s. Then we went public in August of 1984, and we went public in the UK. We're public on the UK market, which is the equivalent of the New York Stock Exchange. We're also public on the Amsterdam Stock Exchange, which is, by way of coincidence, the oldest stock exchange in the world. Most people don't realize the first stock exchange that was ever developed was in Amsterdam. But there was a window of opportunity that existed in London from about February of 84 through September of 84. And Mark Harrison, who's now vice chairman and co-founder and head of corporate development, saw that window, actually convinced me. I was against going public. I thought it was too soon. But he badgered me and the other directors long enough to finally convince us to do it, and it was the right thing to do. Our timing was absolutely perfect. Well, unfortunately, because the company has become so large, it's very difficult for me to go and be able to touch, feel, and interface with every employee. The important thing is for the top five or six people in the company to be able to have five or six people, to be able to have those five or six people, to be able to be like disciples, to be able to bring down to a secretary in our field office in Utah what the company's all about. The company was based on four or five precepts, of which none of which have really changed in the last 5 years. One of which is I've already mentioned is to try to be the 50th largest E&P company in the United States. Another one is to not only at the top, but filter down, as Mr. Reagan would say, all the riches of the company, so even the smallest secretary in our smallest field office benefits as the company benefits. Too often you see most of the profits and the perks and the goodies taken off at the top 10% level. We base this company on one of the most important precepts is if the company makes money, all employees make money. And the receptionist to me, if the company doesn't make money, then you just get paid your salary. And our salaries are not as high as some of our competitors. Maybe that's why over 1,000 exploration production companies have gone out of business in the last 4 or 5 years. But we have people, as hopefully you'll be interviewing later on this evening, that took massive pay cuts to come to work here. And I think it's important to ask them, why would you take a 20 or 40% pay cut with no contracts to come to work for Great Western? And hopefully you'll get a flavor for that. The third precept this company was based on was the fact that we take pride in that none of the founders were oil men. All three of us were actually finance men. Mark Harrison was a partner in the largest law firm in the world. Charlie Soliday was a partner with Coopers & Lybrand, one of the big eight accounting firms. I was from Wall Street, and the precepts that we use generically to run the company, you could run a widget company, a real estate company, or any kind of company, and we take a lot of pride in that, and we never got bogged down with the ideas that we were petroleum engineers or geologists. Now, more recently, we've added the technical expertise, especially with the addition of Gary Loveless, who is the president of one of the companies we acquired, LMB, who's a petroleum engineer by education, one of the best in the business, and he has headed up our technical team, and he runs our exploration production company. So we have grown to a size now that we need that technical expertise, but initially, at our embryonic stages, we didn't have that, and we think that we were lucky that we didn't have oil expertise, as it were. It's important for me as chief executive, who normally gets all the credit, I also get all the blame when things go wrong. Well, right now I'm getting a lot of credits that aren't necessarily, or should be, I should say, shared with a lot of other people. We have 1,400 employees. We have 15 or 20 key executives that, without their assistance, without their perseverance, without their unswerving loyalty, Great Western wouldn't be where it is today. It's to give those people credit. It's also to give the employees, now that there are 1,400, that I may never get an opportunity to sit down and talk to see something like this and to be able to have pride and feel good about the fact that they are part of an organization that is, as far as we can tell, the fastest growing natural resource company in 1986 and perhaps the fastest growing natural resource company in the last 5 years. These offices, this new corporate headquarters, the Great Western Resources, was the brainchild of my former partner and co-founder, Charlie Soliday, who recently passed away January this year.
This room and the company are legacies that Charlie's left us, and because he was a benchmark of excellence, we feel that for all time eternal that our boardroom will always be called this. We hope it makes him happy.
Oh, they never considered not succeeding. And we had a really good team.
I think it was important that one of the things I said earlier on when I was being interviewed, that without the support of our wife, Cindy, and Maureen for Mark, and Linda for myself, they never once flinched. They were unswerving in their support. And as I said earlier, the company wouldn't be here today without Charlie, and without Charlie, as as far as Cindy was concerned and her support. And that's why we thought tonight was important. And as difficult as this is, you know, it's important. And because Great Western is living, Charlie is living in our own minds, hearts.
The open house reception was quite an affair. Fine music and gourmet food lent an impressive air to the evening, and all who were seeing the offices for the first time were duly impressed. A few observations from a group of respected members of the business community outside Great Western Resources. These gentlemen have all seen Great Western grow and prosper. We'll hear their opinions of Great Western as a corporation, Dan Pena, and what the future might be for Great Western as it continues to grow.
I also think that Great Western has started to increase its base of oil and gas and coal reserves at a very good time. When the market is at what we think are historic lows, Great Western has come and has acquired significant holdings both in oil and gas and in coal. And the upside potential is very, very great given the base that they have built currently, and I know will continue to build. Well, they'll be much larger. They most likely will have diversified into some other areas that they aren't in currently. But I do see their basis in coal, the grounding in coal and oil and gas as being the primary cornerstones of their business as they move forward.
He had to convince merchant bankers, he had to convince investors, he had to convince oil people on this side to believe in what he was doing. And all of this happening at the same time, and truly with what we used to call blue sky, you know, because you really don't have a property. And at that time, we found it extremely difficult to buy properties. A little bit easier now, but there's less money now. Mm-hmm. He had an ability to work with the merchant banks, to work with the people who had the money, to work on this side of the ocean, and find those properties and make it all happen very quickly. I would not cut short the support he had, because Soliday wore his clothes out from the inside. He was a remarkable worker and with great drive and enthusiasm, and it was Soliday that welded people like me to the company. And of course Mark Harrison, take nothing from him, but Dan's magnetism. We all go out of our way to go to his birthday party in Scotland.
I think that Great Western will do well in any endeavor they attempt, because they're a close-knit organization. They've got very talented and very professional management at top, and I think that's where it all begins. Plus, they have a very personable leader in Mr. Pena, and of course, Mark Harrison, and a group of other corporate executives that I've met. I think it's a team effort.
They were in there buying their production and their companies while the industry was looking at $9, $10, and $11 oil when in-ground reserves were probably selling at $5, $6, $4, and $3, who knows. And when the Saudis ratchet the price up to $30, $40, and $50 a barrel in the 90s, as well documented in the media today, they'll kill them.
They've acquired some interest in coal, they have some interest in oil, they have some interest in natural gas. To the extent Dan and Mark are planning to expand into other fields, the company will be protected in just about any kind of economic climate and the way it's being run now. I think that kind of company can survive any kind of economic shock. It's the companies that have been collapsing now are companies that are overextended, poorly managed, and with a lot of fat. You're not going to have that problem with these two guys. Dan Pena once said that he was going to make his company the next Exxon. And at the time, that seemed like more of a pipe dream, and now I'm not so sure.
Unquestionably, his personality tends to be the reason why it moved forward. Because when you think back, the company was floated at a time when the oil market was actually peaking. And it was only in the 2 years after that that he managed to acquire other companies and build up the company to a very large company, culminating in the deal which he did at the end of last year. And without his drive, there's no doubt they wouldn't have managed to do that, in which case the company would bust.
You know, there's always in periods of slowdown or depression certain people that succeed, and these people are going to succeed excuse me, under any conditions. And I believe you've got a group of people here that their style, that they would succeed at anything they attempted. And they did enter the energy business at a time when it was down, but they have succeeded. And I, like I said before, I think these people would succeed in anything that you try. The firm I'm with, we are just very pleased to be associated with them. It's exciting, it's fun, and that's what makes our life really very interesting.
We were involved, and I was involved with the company from the moment it came to the market in London, and we've sort of watched it grow through difficult circumstances, and we've had some part in that growth and helping Dan and his colleagues to grow the company. And we have just a very good relationship with them, as well as finding it rewarding business, an interesting business. It's also very nice business too, because we like the people and we enjoy their company, and I think we all get on very well. You know, I and my colleagues at Greenwells have a great deal of affection for Dan and his team. Well, when Dan came to the market, we heard earlier on this evening about he and his colleagues' dream or vision of becoming one of the top 50 exploration companies in the States, and I suppose if you'd said that when they came to the market, there wouldn't have been very many people who would have believed it. But the success they've achieved against a very difficult background suggests that that's one shouldn't be too skeptical about it. And I think they have got, with the team they've got and the opportunities available to them, or the opportunities they'll seek out and find, because that's the way they are, I think they have got a chance of making the business really a very major force in the market over here.
Dan Pena has had a colorful past. As you have heard, Mr. Pena has no lack of energy and equally no lack of personality. During his years in the real estate business, on Wall Street, and now in the oil business, Dan Pena has developed many loyal friendships. Few will disagree. Much of Great Western success is due to Dan Pena and his personality. To get a unique insight to Dan Pena, we'll hear first from a few of his close friends, then Linda Pena, his wife of 14 years.
Now, I remember his company in his home in Palos Verdes, him and a secretary, in a bedroom they had converted to, you know, with office equipment. You just, like I said, you hope and pray that they could put something together, which is what they were trying to do. There was no Mark Harrison then, there was no Charlie Soliday. None of these people were involved at that time. Just him and a secretary, a telephone, and whatever office, I guess he had a computer or whatever else was up there. And here we are. I just think it's unlimited. You know, he has a vision. Believe me, there's a plan and a design here. This is not just tripping around and, there's a design and a plan, and I'm sure there's no limit in his mind.
I own the Gateway Motel in Graham, and when Dan started, I think it was his first drilling venture, it was in Graham, Texas. And so they practically lived in my motel for a long while. Well, see, I knew Dan before he was with Great Western. He was with another company when I knew him. And probably one of the first things that made him stand out in my mind was that the people who had known him for a long while respected him, and there was a lot of loyalty there. And so I think this, he's not always changing people like a lot of people do, you know. He's loyal to the people, and I'm sure that they're in return are loyal to him. So some of the people who came into the motel and were associated with him in the other business he was in had known him for a lot of years and were still working with him. So I think that says a whole lot for him.
Well, I've known Dan for a long time, and he's very creative, very imaginative, and he gets in there and takes a shot. He's a very personable fellow, and you know, the only way you can succeed in this thing is to share it. And that's something a lot of people have trouble understanding, and Dan doesn't have that problem. Well, a lot of people kind of like consolidate their position and not spread it around, and you don't build much on that. You can make it one time, but you don't. You can't grow. And so I think that this, what's happened lately with the company and its incredible growth, you know, in the last, 3 years, has been as a direct result of the power of the personality behind it.
They are in a true adventure, and that's the only way I can explain it. I think my husband and the group of people who work for him are going to be able to fulfill a dream in their lifetime, and there are many people who dream about a dream and already have put fences up around it and have already said, oh, I can't do that. Whereas my husband knows no fences, and the people that work for him are terribly dedicated. He is the one with the dream. He is the one that has the genius. But they are the ones who make it happen. In today's society, he is a very rare commodity. He is basically, I guess that's what I'd want to say, the Don Quixote, the one who's fighting the windmills. And he truly believes it, and he truly does it. There are a lot of people who talk that way and don't back up. And if you're a person who's fortunate enough to, not everyone can believe, not everyone can have that faith, but the people that have worked for him, they have given that faith. And as we talked before, Charlie Soliday, who we feel is very much part of this company, was one of those people who, from the time I think he and I understood my husband, I think from the first time he met him, he knew this was someone that he was going to have a relationship with and believe totally. And of course, Charlie had a wife, 3 children, and that was what was so special. He had a very, very good job with Coopers and Lybrand. And my husband at the time that he was working in that bedroom had said, I basically can't even pay you a salary, and I think it would be wonderful if you left your company and we paid you nothing and you left your wife for a while. And Charlie said, yes, I believe you. And Cindy has a relationship, as Dan and I do, that she was able to say, yes, I believe in it too. And that, I mean, not only do we feel a loss of Charlie, but also the fact that we were so fortunate to have him in our life, that is something that not only for us, for our children, for his wife, I mean, that is the type of quality that goes on forever. And we were just so blessed to have him in our life, and that's how we feel tonight, too. And Dan, in his life, is trying to be the very best business person, build a business that is something that people look up to, not only for its, not so much how much money it makes, but just a good, solid business, something that you feel at the end of the day that you've done something that's worthwhile, that you've enjoyed doing it. And there was a young man that we met tonight that's just recently come to Great Western. And he said that he'd worked for several companies, and that he had a feeling of excitement being here. And I think that's how a lot of people feel. So whether it becomes bigger, which I'm sure it will, I hope that that side of it, I hope that excitement is always maintained. And when Dan is gone, the company will be an example and will live on and still have that type of leadership.
The people at Great Western are young, ambitious, and extremely dedicated. Great Western won't continue to grow unless its people continue to work at the level and pace they have maintained in the past. One can get a fine impression of the ambition and dedication of Great Western people by hearing from a few of its own. Let's listen to some of the fine people of Great Western Resources Houston corporate headquarters.
Having represented Great Western for a couple of years, I knew their history, their business history. I knew Mr. Pena's method of doing business, and I also knew Mark and Charlie very well. And I believe that there was more risk staying with the law firm career-wise than there was coming with Great Western. It was just a great opportunity. And Mr. Pena believes in growth, and so do I, so it seemed like it was a good fit. The senior management at Great Western across the board all comes from a similar background. I don't think any of us were born with a silver spoon. And I think it lends a little to the company that we all are trying to build something here. I mean, individually we're trying to progress, obviously, but I think the company benefits from all the senior managers having the concept of hard work, growth built into their lifestyles. Pre-Great Western, it's just run over here, and then Dan being the driver that he is, I think he's just using the tools that he has in the company.
Mark, Dan, Charlie, when Charlie was here, Bob, everybody's just really gung-ho, you know, and I think everybody really wants to do well. And I love it. I mean, I really enjoy working for Great Western.
We don't have to live with the obsolete practices that, to a certain extent, created a situation where certain investors were not given any bottom line income. We can benefit from the economies of scale, and yet we don't have to live with the practices that beat down the industry in the last few years. I like dealing with the management structure as it exists today, and there is a free exchange of ideas, and I feel that's a real positive benefit to not only the investors but the people that I work with day to day, the supporting staff. They're all very comfortable with their position in the company and wanting to move forward.
Energy of people, mostly of these people. There's a lot of young people in the company. It's a young company, and we work hard. And we know that it's only going to grow if we give it 100%. If it takes 110, we're willing to do it. When I talk to people, my big line has always been, we're not run by engineers. We're run by entrepreneurs, financiers, who have a head for money and know how to use it well. And I have to put all my trust into those men.
The best way to understand Great Western Resources and the reasons for its success is to listen to the men at the top, those who head departments and sit at the board, have the best insights. Here, comments from the men who lead Great Western Resources.
Mr. Pena does not send management in or try to manage from a foreign base. If the operation had not been successful, he probably wouldn't have bought it. If it hadn't been successful and he had a purchase anyway, he would have changed management. He wouldn't have gone with a loser. Mr. Pena is different from the other oil and gas company for a simple reason is he tries to let it run from the area that it should be run from, and that's at the roots of the operation, not from Houston or not from Denver, like a lot of the companies are trying to run their operation on a diversified manner when they go from oil and gas to coal, or vice versa. And I see the Great Western becoming, I think what Mr. Pena told me in the early days that I met him, that he wants to be a Fortune 200 company. And I see it headed in that direction. This last acquisition certainly was a big one, and I know that they're looking at opportunities in oil and gas, and I know they're looking at opportunities in coal, and we have one just about ready to unfold. When you prove yourself to people, as quick as he's proven himself to people like me, you know, like I say, I saw him in action, and I know that he does what he says he'll do, and I have total confidence in him, and that's quick. A lot of times it takes years to develop that, but with Mr. Dan Pena, not only myself, but a lot of people back in my neck of the woods have the utmost respect for him and the Great Western Company.
Well, Great Western's always been pretty picky about prospects and properties. The biggest thing, of course, would be that they never incurred any debt and debt service. That's the big difference. Also, in hindsight, the timing was pretty good. A great number of the companies that are belly up now are that way because they went out banking on $40 or better crude prices, and Great Western never did. So I see Great Western heading pretty much in the same direction that they've been going, moving on to bigger, better things in the oil industry, as well as diversifying in other energy areas like coal. There appear to be some real opportunities in the coal arena.
I don't know that I've ever met anyone any more positive than Dan. And like you can hear him outside the door, no telling how far down the hall. Uh-huh. Certainly he's in command of anyone and everyone whenever he's in the room. No, being a financial person, I think that it's much more important to have a financial person running a company, particularly in today's times, than it is to have some geologist or engineer sitting out there hoping to have their wells drilled and, you know, without regard to the financial responsibilities that go along with operating a company. So you know, I think it's just a wonderful company to be able to be associated with. I've seen a lot of companies struggle for survival. We've looked at a lot of them, you know, in our efforts to acquire properties, and it's very comforting to be on the Great Western team.
Yeah, I think Great Western has a strong management team, has made appropriate moves in this market, and consequently are seeing the results of that. Unlike many companies, as you pointed out, they've prospered, and I think will continue to do so. Great Western is an acquisition mode company, and we hope to make a number of other acquisitions before the end of the year. I think that when you have professionals like we have in this organization, that those people see an opportunity to grow with Great Western, opportunity for themselves, and it's more than just a top-oriented company. And by that I mean, we have people in middle management and lower management, people that a lot of times do not get recognized, that are very capable kinds of individuals. And so when we have that strength that permeates the company from top to the field operations, then it makes for an overall successful company.
In all aspects of business, timing is a big factor. And I think Dan's timing as far as some of the strategic moves he's made, you know, relative to this company and the acquisitions they've made to date, and have been at a good time, and I think that he has a lot of vision and has a lot of has a lot of financial backing. There's a lot of people out in various credit markets in London and throughout the states here that have a lot of confidence in the man, it takes a lot of confidence together with a lot of vision and the capability of putting together a good management team underneath you, to build a good company.
But we knew that to the extent the prices ever did come down, people who had a lot of debt were going to have trouble. So we decided when we first went public not to incur any debt. And that's what's kept us out of trouble, because you can always control your costs if you don't have fixed debt service. And we were able to do that and operate with low overheads, which meant low salaries to ourselves, and unfortunately for all of our employees, to them as well. But they persevered through the tough times, and as a result, they're all doing very well, and as a company does well. I think without Dan, there wouldn't be a Great Western in the early years. I think, fortunately, as the company grows, and as unfortunately we've had to see with Charlie's death, is that we're to the size and the point now where each one of us individually becomes less important the ongoing operations of this company. But even with that, without Dan, the company would suffer. It would go on, it would make money, but it wouldn't go on and expand at the level it's going to, we think, with Dan running this company. But Dan's a very interesting individual, because most people who don't know him, or at least know him well, think that Dan is a very flashy individual, very outspoken, all of which is true. But he's also the most conservative, careful businessman that I've ever met. My background, in the sense that I've always thought I was very conservative. Our professional advisors, some of who are in this room with us now, also are very conservative. None of them as conservative as Dan. So when you look to see what Dan is trying to build and where we're trying to build the company, what he's trying to build is a monument to himself and the rest of our shareholders that our children and families can look back on and be proud of down the road, but in a conservative, careful manner so that we don't jeopardize or risk what we've developed up to this point. We don't think we have any limit. We have certain goals over the next 3, 5, 10 years. I think that Dan and myself are looking to a point 9 years from now where we've built this company into a $2 or $3 billion asset company that we can look back on, be proud of, have some very talented young people, who some of whom are in the company now, others whom we'll bring in over the years, who can take over and run this company with us overseeing it. We don't think there's a limit to the future for this company.
We have 8.5 years of our 10-year plan, which coincides with my 50th birthday. I would say that in 8.5 years, we'll probably have something on the order of magnitude of 20 to 30,000 employees. We will probably be international. We will be in at least one or two other natural resources. Could be lumber. I think that the prognostications that you see about the oil and gas business will have less and less effect on us the larger we get. I think that we may not very well be headquartered in Houston. We may be in New York. We may be in London. I believe that I will probably not be president of the company by that time. And I am most likely at that time, or right about that time, I will probably step aside not retire, but probably do something else.
Following the general open house, Mr. Pena hosted a smaller gathering of selected guests at Houston's Hyatt Regency Hotel. The group was treated to dancing and a selection of desserts prepared by the hotel staff. Later in the evening, Mr. Pena presented an informal talk to those gathered. He spoke of those who had helped Great Western along the way and gave his thoughts on the future of the company. Mr. Dan Pena.
One, I want to thank all the professionals and some of the Porter professionals that represent us. Our bankers, our lawyers, our accountants, our engineers, both petroleum and mining, our stockbrokers, our merchant bankers, etc., etc. Because without their support, we wouldn't be here today, and we wouldn't be a viable and burgeoning company in natural resources. We were founded on July 13, 1982, when oil was approximately $36 or $35 a barrel, and with $820. We are now a $310 million company. Oil has bounced off $8 or $10, and we are back to $18 or $19. But without the support of those professionals, we wouldn't be here. Because in times gone by, as some of our lawyers, not Johnson and Swanson necessarily, but Finley Kimball, who's represented tonight, we paid our lawyers and our accountants at that time one time a year, whether we needed to or not. And basically, I see Bud Grawl is laughing over there, who's one of our bankers now, one of our more friendly bankers. We paid our professionals at that time one time a year, whether we needed to or not. And basically, we rode them like banks. And we appreciate that, and that's why we're very, very loyal to the professionals that represented us 4 or 5 years ago. It's hard to believe that the company is will be 5 years old this July, 4 years and 9 months right now, approximately. And it's hard to believe that the company was founded in what is now the nursery of our summer home, my wife's, my summer home in Palos Verdes, with two people, and which was my secretary at that time, myself, and then joined by Charlie Soliday and Mark Harrison, and soon 4 or 5 employees. And when we went public in August of 84, we had, I think, 16 or 17 employees. Now we have 1,400. It's really hard to believe. And if it wasn't for the professionals and the, many of the people in this room this evening, that wouldn't have happened. And I'm thankful, and I want to take this opportunity to say that without your support, it wouldn't have happened. Mark, myself, and Charlie, who passed away in January, we had a dream. And the professionals, rightly or wrongly, supported us. They believed in our dream. And we'll never forget that. And that's why we still do business with certain lawyers, or law firms, I should say, and certain accounting firms. Because no matter how big we get, I don't think that'll ever pass. I don't think that that feeling of gratitude will ever pass. Subsequent to that, we have added new relationships with new law firms, new accounting firms, and new merchant bankers, new investment bankers, etc. But those original firms will never forget. And as long as I'm with Great Western, God willing, I'll be there a long, long time, but we'll never forget that support that we got. For all the people that have joined us recently, like the Coal Enterprise, Clyde Gaughans, I love coal, Clyde. Clyde, I mean, I love coal. I can't even remember why I got no own gas business. I love coal.
Gary.
Okay. And Gary Loveless, who, without his professional expertise and his rocket scientists, that I like to call him, I mean, our oil and gas business probably wouldn't be anywhere near what it is today. And Judy, his lovely wife. Gary has uplifted with his staff our oil and gas expertise. Like, I mean, we feel that we can compete with anybody. And for the new additions, thanks, hon. Yeah, and with Bob McCurry on the accounting side and finance side, and the new additions of Bill Phillips, And we're very, very fortunate. I mean, we got so many bright people. We're very, very lucky. And I'm very thankful. And as long as my wife, Linda, God bless her, continues to support me, being gone 60%, 70%, 80% of the time, we're going to fulfill our goal as being one of the top 50 E&P companies in the United States. And I just want to take this opportunity to thank you all, spouses, non-spouses, employees, non-employees, for all the support you've given me. God bless you. Have a pleasant evening. Thank you very much.